maybe give people sort of what we were talking about that was so interesting to me when we were coming in from the airport yesterday.
Which was
and you were just telling me about how you started off DJing.
Yeah.
How like music came into your life. So to kind of give people an idea of like how, yeah, like where music started for you, even maybe like childhood.
Yeah.
And how it grew into like what it is today for you.
Or do you want me to just start now?
I mean, yeah, this like the first thing that comes to your mind.
First
like
childhood. My dad's just always been into music. My sister a few years older than me, so she'd get picked up missing music and that from school and stuff like that. My dad were always playing like, we call it Northern Soul. It's just a sound. It's kind of like a precursor to what we know as club music nowadays. Like, we were just up north of England, people buying rare soul records from all over America, like stuff that nobody else would listen to. And then it was quite up-tempo, so, and he'd go to them sort of clubbing things, it was always around me. And then after that, my first real, like, getting into music was about, I don't know, probably like 8, 9, maybe a bit younger. My sister's happy hardcore tapes and stuff like that. Like, so I was listening to like, I used to fall asleep listening to full on like 160 happy hardcore, like banging when I was like 7 or 8 years old.
Wow. So that's a really interesting early influence. Yeah. I couldn't imagine myself like listening to that kind of music at that
age. It's just really popular in sort of working class parts of England and stuff. So
yeah. And so this Northern Soul.
Yeah.
This was an expression used for this kind of curation of rare soul records, yeah, just, that DJs and collectors were doing.
Yeah, it's just then. To do with the fact that it was played in northern towns and cities.
That's interesting. I haven't heard that that expression.
It's worth. There's quite a lot of stuff to like. There's documentaries to watch on it, which are quite interesting.
Northern Soul.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay,
yeah.
Then that's
literally it. it's like the precursor of where after. You sort of after that, the next sort of thing were acid house. So that's the next stage. You know, it's the original people running around dark rooms. They used to take barbiturates and like uppers and downers, what they got, like medicinal cabinet ones and stuff like that. And then they just dance all night and stuff like that. So
it's kind of like the show Skins. Do you know that TV show?
Yeah, I remember that. I can't remember that. That's so long ago.
That's just kind of what it reminds me of. But so it was both dad and sister.
Yeah.
And I mean, very early, but then like teenage years.
I just come across stuff like a lot of hip hop when I was probably like when I sort of started 12, 13, when I started the next level of school or whatever it's called. I can't remember, like secondary school, I guess. I got into hip hop a bit more. I probably disconnected a little bit from like dance music a bit more.
The same kind of phase.
Yeah. And then just always is quite a varied taste of music. I just used to go to CDs. I had no real idea of DJing as such, you know what I mean? I used to buy tape packs and stuff like that, but I was too young to go out and see DJs. They weren't everywhere. It's not like these days where you like everywhere you look there's a DJ, is it, you know? So I didn't have that. I just used to go out and buy random CDs, stuff like that. And then I probably got decks around about 15, 16 maybe.
You got your own decks?
Yeah, I got like I hung around with some people who had some decks, so then I saw them. Then.
But like CDJs or vinyl?
Cheap ones, just like.
The two turntables and a mixer?
Some 200 quid setup. We had a cracker little Behringer mixer, like terrible. I think it had like a bass, I don't even know what EQ, we didn't even have a full, it definitely didn't have a full EQ on it. and then just trying to mix by myself and just absolutely. I mean, no clue what I was fucking doing. Like, I think it took me a minute. You know, like when you start doing it, you get into it, and you're like, I can't do it. Like, I just kept, I persisted at it, recorded myself, and then managed to start mixing.
And so at that time, was it like a hobby thing, or were you already sort of playing also like at like parties or friend stuff? Or
At the very start, then I started playing like friend stuff and little local bits and bobs.
Yeah. So this was around high school.
Nah, this is after high school. This now, when I probably started playing.
Like playing a little bit out.
I kind of got them and didn't do a great deal with the decks at first in terms of teaching myself. And I weren't ready. I mean, even when you're first playing out, you're not ready. Like, you know.
Yeah. But, so it was more like kind of a. you knew you wanted it, but it, like you I, just weren't yeah, fit, I wasn't ready for it.
I just wanted that. I wanted to mix records into records, and that was it. I've never known every single sort of stage of my life, probably until now. I've never really aspired to go too much further with music. Well, not further as such, just I just do it for music. Do you know what I mean? I'm gonna do it regardless anyway. So there's not that aspiration of like, I want to be fucking global superstar.
That just happened accidentally. But then, so you started kind of DJing kind of casually around town, yeah. And then that kind of persisted through your...
I just did bits and bobs. I did like little residency shows in town and stuff like that. Not proper residency, I was just the guys and club nights.
Yeah.
And then, because Doncaster is quite well connected to some bigger cities, like Sheffield and Leeds, you can just sort of go there. And then I got a, there's a pirate radio, well, there used to be a pirate radio station in Leeds. So I just sent them an email, got together a little mix and stuff, didn't really expect to. And then I got a show on their radio station, and that did a lot for me.
Nice. Which radio show? Can people go back and listen to it?
Nah, I doubt it. I don't think they'll be on anywhere. It was called Radio Frequency. I mean, if you search my name in Radio Frequency, there might be somewhere, but it won't be good, probably.
What kind of stuff was it then?
Like quite garagey, probably.
Yeah.
Like, maybe, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably like in that phase, sort of gap when the dubstepy garage sort of phase, if I couldn't, it's hard to explain it. Like a bit all over the shop. Like,
yeah.
But not where we are nowadays. We're all over the shop, less refined, you know?
And when did you first start producing music?
I don't know what date, what years. I feel like it was maybe like 9 or 10 years ago. But
how in timeline wise, how does that match up to like getting the kind of bigger local cities DJing, and then how did that lead into like whether you just wanted to do DJing or also produce music, like how did that look for you?
The production thing, like I said, it kind of came about more from other people, my friends who like downloaded a crack copy of Reason and had the, like I say, that capability of look, who were willing to sit in front of a computer and do that, because I've never been into the computer part of it. It's bores me, like, you know. Yeah, so we did that. I had that group, well, it was called Mr. Men. It was me, and it started out originally two of us, and then one guy decided he didn't want to do it. But we did a few bits. We did Sub Club, we played somewhere in Amsterdam, some YouTube shows in London, and that. For us, it was crazy.
That was a couple of you together?
Yeah.
How many?
There were two of us. He decided that he liked indie music and wanted to.
Hey,
yeah.
To each his own.
Yeah,
exactly. And then how long did that go for?
A good few years. We released quite a bit. We released quite a few records. We actually did the first ever Hot House, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, 001s by us. Like,
nice.
And we did like more. Yeah, we did a few EPs with Rupert. We were known to the known like Rupert guys and stuff like that.
Nice.
It was kind of like a...
I need to go back and...
Yeah, it doesn't sound great mixed sounds like, but like... the ideas of it were cool and that, and it definitely had, you know, there were a little bit of an impact. Impact, played on radio and stuff like that.
Yeah. So first you kind of started off on your own, like locally DJing around bigger cities, and then Mr. Men came about?
Yeah, then Mr. Men came about.
And then how did Mella Dee then?
Mella Dee already existed because of me doing the radio show.
So that was actually before Mr. Man already. So Mella Dee was always your name as a solo.
I had like a name before I started, and I had to change it because there was some guy on the radio station who had the same name. So literally,
what was that? Can you tell us?
It was cushy. It was terrible. I'm glad that I had to change it. But I've never liked Mella Dee as a name either. So
really,
yeah, not for.
How where did it come from, Mella Dee?
I needed a name like that, so I had to just sort of think of one.
And it's just like a made up.
It just came, and then the melody, the way that it's spelled, and the reason it is because the way that we say melody in Yorkshire, like.
But as in melody, like as in melody in a song.
As in like musical, as in like a musical melody. Song, yeah, is how it is. But that if
melody.
You say, but that melody.
How do you say?
Melody.
Melody.
Right, it's melody. It's melody. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But and then I met the DEE, you know, that's the sort of play. Yeah. There used to be like a grab MC called DEE. So we'd play on, the idea was stuff, just play on stuff like that.
Nice.
Yeah, so it's all in parallel, really, I suppose, that Mr. Man.
Were you making music on your own as well next to Mr. Man, or?
Yeah, I was playing about, we'd just sort of make ideas together, but then it just, I think I just got to a point where I'm not very good at compromising someone else's taste. We had different tastes. John, who did it, he was more, nowadays he makes drum and bass a lot more and stuff like that, and I think, I would come in more from like the DJ side of things and being in the clubs and being like, this is what I want to play, and then just stepped out and started trying to do my own thing a bit more.
And then started releasing more actively solo.
Yeah.
And then, you were telling me that you were still working a job until like 2 years ago or something?
No, like that? More like, I was 27, so 5 years ago.
So 5 years ago. And then how did that look for you? That's really interesting to me. Like, you were doing, Mella Dee was already parallel with Mr. Man, went about a little bit. I mean, Sub Club is pretty serious. So you guys got around quite a bit. How did that coincide with kind of, you know, you moving to London and sort of, you know, quitting the 9-to-5 and that kind of like shift in your life?
Yeah, I just did it alongside anyway, and I was thankful that I had a job where I had a little bit of flexibility at least, so I could sort of that, right?
Yeah, for sure.
I've got a gig this like tonight, some days I'd go do a gig, drive back from, I'd do a lot of shows in Leeds, at different like student parties and all sorts of stuff. And I'd, you know, get in at 4 in the morning, then get up early and go out and fit doors and stuff. But then it's when my fiance finished uni and she decided that she wanted to work in music and that, and then she got an internship. And then that was just a good way. She got an internship in London because there's nowhere to work. If you're not in London, you're probably not going to be working in music. Unless, like,
must be similar to like the countryside in Hungary and moving to Budapest.
Yeah, you need to be in the mix of it. I mean, there is no other city, especially because London's like the hub of the music industry.
That's true.
In England. It's like, there's so much going off there. So she started doing an internship down there, and that was just a good call to move down and give it a bit more of a crack, you know?
Nice.
But see what happened. Although I've never really had much in the way of expectations. It's always just been, I'm going to keep doing it.
And then, obviously, the elephant in the room is warehouse music. So how did that, you know, where did that come from? How was that whole
situation? That came from me just, it's a bit frustration.
Yeah, that's, I didn't want to ask that. Yeah, but it's just frustration.
That's what, I say it all the time. It's like, I got bored of people being like, we released so much music.
Yeah, I was checking here.
Like, that's the thing, because there's obviously a lot of people think I'm brand new.
Oh, no.
I know it doesn't take much. Plenty of people understand that, but you can be obviously seen as that. It's like, I've done so much. And I'd go to do EPs with someone or send someone music to put out, and you'd send them a few tracks, and they'd like one, and then you'd spend another however long trying to please somebody in terms of like trying to get number two. And then just got to a point where I was like, originally I was just going to put them out on white label, just call it like Mella Dee white label stamp, no thought, just get the music out there. And then I'd just literally go to sleep one night and just bang warehouse music. I'm like, that kind of makes sense. And then and then thought about the logo, just like design of it, which happens.
And then building?
Yeah, that's Doncaster Warehouse.
So that's building in Doncaster.
Yeah, that's like that's the only clue. It used to have big names playing there. It's just kind of a weird sort of...
Oh, it's a club?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, so it's just like, it's the club that's on my side of town as well. It's quite rough, it's quite different, but it's like, it's cool to have that sort of graphic as well, you know?
Oh, I thought it was your office.
No, it's just the warehouse. But it's the club that's in Doncaster. It's the only place that it's an actual decent sort of space, but people don't go there because it's a little bit rough, but I want to do something special there, so...
Nice.
When did that come about? I mean, it's like 2 years now, maybe, something like that, I guess, I think.
And then, before you put out Techno Disco Tool, did you have any kind of, like, do you remember, like, before you put it out to the world, what your feelings were like towards it?
I knew it, I know people had enjoyed it.
Yeah.
But not to that level. I mean, I knew it did what it did. Do you know what I mean? When I was making it, I'm like, yeah, that's gonna, people are gonna enjoy that, you know? But I didn't realise how much. There was no way I could do it. I mean, a lot of it, that, it's been a whirlwind since that thing.
Yeah.
But I've been ready for it, so it's been alright. So it's felt like I've had a lot of years knocking at the door, and then I've been like, alright.
I mean, and now it's time to...
It's just giving me a chance to show everything else as well, you know?
And I mean, it's just giving you the chance to show, like, holy shit, like, yesterday, I mean, you played a pretty... me and the team, we were, saying, like, this was one of the most enjoyable nights we've had at Toldi. I mean, you held the crowd really good for, 6 hours, and it was just... really a different feeling to know that there's one person, they're on the music the whole night, and man, it was really, really enjoyable. So I'm really happy that this techno disco tool and this whole warehouse music situation happened, because it's just kind of a weird thing, I think, in the industry. Like, you have one hit and that gets you in the door, and then It's actually a saving grace that you're like a really good DJ, because that's where a lot of the other it's ones fall. Is like they have their track, they have theirs, and then they go DJ, and it's
Well, that's the thing, like I said, because I've been playing as a residence when I was younger, to playing slots where nobody cared who I wore anyway. I'm just providing the music, so.
Yeah, but you were ready for it. I mean, you did the back work.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's the thing. Now it's all changed. And in terms of even production and stuff, because I'm in the studio, every day.
Really?
Yeah, every day. Unless I really, really can't be bothered. I'll be in there. Because I'll get up with my fiancé, and then she'll go to work, and then when I just... It's like a 15-minute walk. I'll walk up there, turn on my machines, and just play. I don't necessarily record anything or do anything every day, but...
Just practicing,
being in there, listening to music in there, whatever. I don't take it lightly what I do.
Yeah.
Like, I want to make sure that I'm always working to do the best that I can do and stuff like that. And that requires work, you know.
Sounds like a really healthy balance. Like, you don't care about that up there, but still, it's like you're very, very much on your duty.
I want to be the best of what the best is subjective, it's music.
But the best to you.
I want you to
feel the best about what you're doing.
I've got plenty of music, I'm always working on music, so I keep my music in people's records bags.
And what's the plan? Do you just want to keep pushing the warehouse music thing? And
I'm going to do releases still with other labels and stuff.
Yeah.
But warehouse music's always going to be the one, because it's just complete carte blanche. I can do what I want to do, no one can tell me nothing.
And how many releases are you planning? Because it's been quite a lot, and you've released under different names as well.
Northern Jams is me, and actually, have you ever heard of Mac and Pace Man? Well, they used to be about, they're actually just doing the last release because I've decided to call it, but one of the guys from Mac and Pace Man, Craig, he's amazing. He's beyond talented in the studio and stuff like that. He's just wild. So it's me and him, but we might do Northern Jams, but we've also, I played some tracks last night actually, and we've done something called Jeff and Ryan, because he just wants to work on the name Jeff, and I was just like, I was writing it just nice and easy. We're gonna do some stuff, finish up some EPs. I've got another EP coming out in March. Something kind of 4-track.
Nice.
I've probably got 10 tunes that I could use as well. I just want to keep music. I want to get music out 4 EPs a year, at least. If I've got the work rate, if I can do it, and then being able to just use random different names and stuff like that, it means that I can separate stuff a bit.
Yeah. And so, this all night long thing versus playing the kind of standard 2 or 3 hour set, how was that during your kind of career, and how is it now?
I never used to do the all night long until I started in last year, I think it was.
Yeah.
So I just, that was just, like I say.
How did it first start, happening, or?
I think I just decided that I wanted to play, try doing all night long sets.
Yeah, and it just worked.
Yeah, just have a like, just challenge myself. I wasn't prepared. My music used to be like so unorganized. It was just playlists from like 5 years ago.
I respect it, man. I don't know how you can categorize them.
I just went ahead and I was like, right, I'm gonna do this all night long. And then I was like, right, I better still organise my music and stuff like that. But I'm so glad I did, because I love doing it. It's the most draining thing ever.
Yeah.
It's amazing as well.
And then you want to keep doing the all night long thing for a while now?
Yeah. Not every show all night long, but you know, some shows.
Yeah.
A lot of them. I definitely probably do at least one tour of that year, maybe more, because it's fun. People seem to be into it, you know.
Yeah.
And more people are doing the concept as well.
And I think there might actually be something to what I was saying earlier also, how like the one show a weekend, but that show being all night long. I think you may have made, you know, like a bigger impact on this one crowd yesterday than you would have made collectively with like the two or three different crowds that you would have played.
You definitely do.
Fatigue, you know, just like...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I think you've got a good chance to come in and show people what you do and what you're about as well. To some extent, this, you know, obviously, like I said, when you were expecting, you might be heavier last night, but obviously the room went right for it. But it's a good chance to be able to do that. Well, we can go from here to here to here. We'll dance, and you know, and you get to know what the crowd are into and how it feels and stuff like that.
I mean, that also really showed that you were like prepared for it, and you've had the back work where. How we were saying, like, yeah, like judging from your releases, you're like, oh, it's gonna be a bit heavier, and that you could tell, like, you could tell it was not a heavy room.
And
it was so lovely.
It wouldn't have been the right place, but that's the thing. You definitely would get some DJs who'd probably just come in with like this very select idea of what they've got and what they can play, and then they turn up to a space and it doesn't quite fit that, and it's just like they left.
I just think it must be such a, I can imagine it's a very powerful thing. I mean, it is for me, but like, people don't arrive to this club before 1 a.m. usually. And people, before midnight, there was already like 100 people. Before 12:30, we had roughly 250 people already inside, like already over half full. And they were paying attention. And this is like,
yeah,
I think that's a really interesting thing, is like people, you know, they maybe scroll through your SoundCloud and it's like heavy stuff, and then they hear something like this and they're like, okay, wow.
Yeah, we're going to go.
Yeah. I think it's so cool.
Yeah, I started quite slow last night. Slow and low.
And I mean, I think it's really cool also that, like, you know, when we first inquired with your team about bringing you over, we were just like, yeah, like a set. And it's so it was such a kind of nice surprise. Like, oh, like he'd rather play all night long. What do you guys think? It's like, oh, okay, cool.
I guess they just do that. Like, they probably just do that all the time because they know that I'm always, if that chance comes up, I'm probably like, yeah, no worries. Like, I'll play all night long.
I think especially maybe like if you're going around Europe and like Eastern Europe, I think it's really cool.
Yeah, it's all just, night long. It's like the hard part is the actual effort of doing it. But like I say, in comparison to what I actually used to do as work, as a job, this is light work.
For the 6 hours, are you pretty steadily in like a flow, or do you kind of like how? Those 6 hours, how do they seem like 6 hours? Like, how much are you caught up, kind of?
I mean, I try. It flows quite quick normally.
Yeah.
Most times, I'll check on my phone every now and then just to see what time it is, just so I can figure out right, I need to be sort of heading. I can't get stuck here for too long. I need to move on from this idea. That's about it. But it flows quite easy. And in 6 hours at least, if something knocks you off, you've got time to come back from that.
That's true. That's true.
Because that's the inevitability of DJing. There's something can happen that can maybe send you a bit like, oh, am I going right here? Then you have to like come back round or something.
Yeah, yesterday there was that guy.
He gave me
he didn't know where he was, so it wasn't like a personal thing.
No, he just had an idea. It's never his personal. I'm just like such so just I'm like literally the way that I dealt with him, I'm just like move.
No, I tried talking to him and it just wasn't working, and then his friends were really nice and they
I weren't offended by him. I was just like,
Because maybe in that moment you seemed more alarmed than maybe you were actually.
Yeah. I've told you to move a couple of times, and then I saw you. I was like, that guy. You might want to tell him to like fully move, otherwise he's going to be like, get out, like, because you're doing anything.
Dope. Hey, I think it's admirable that we had this conversation like day after the party, after you barely slept and I barely slept.
I'll get through it.
But yeah, I don't know. That was kind of the idea, just like super casual. Casual, you know?
Man. Yeah, man.
I like how at the beginning you're like, do I start now?
Do you want me to talk?
Do you want me to talk?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, let's smoke.